which is the meeting of the Pentecost here in Sestona. And I've been happy to see how well attended our events have been. I was even talking to Jeff, the manager of the Carlisle Inn at the attachment, and he was just telling me that the last event in their attachment Facebook page was over 900 times, which, you know, for this kind of events would be good. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Manuel Lopez, and I'm a professor of religion at the New College of Florida. Also, for those of you who haven't been to these events, the New College is the public arts college of the University of Florida system, and it's next to the Ridley. And I want to welcome everyone to visit if you haven't been. We have a lovely campus by the bay. I also want to suggest that if you haven't been there, you can also check out our website at New College of Florida, and you can see that we have regularly many events and talks and public performances and concerts. And if you go to the website and scroll all the way down, you can see every week what events we have, and we're welcome to come. This public talk series is also part of a class that I've been teaching with J.D. Mellon, who was our speaker last week, at New College of Florida, about the history, practices, and beliefs of the Amish, again with a particular focus on our local and rural community, and as previous events, our students are here. So, our first event 2 weeks ago was a public conversation between J.D. Miller and Katie Troyer, who's also here with us today, which also opened the exhibition of Katie Troyer's photographs, which if you haven't seen, they are outside still at the Carlisle Inn, and they will be here tomorrow. And then beginning on Wednesday, I think it's Wednesday, March 1st, and for the month of March, is going to be at the College Hall at the New College of Florida. So if you go to our website, you'll also see that. Last week, we had a wonderful talk by Jamie Miller about the history of handcraft from the arrival of the first Amish in the 1920s until the 1970s, and it was lovely to see some members of the community here, and we all learned a lot about some facts about the history of handcraft. And today, we're lucky to have Stephen Nolt, professor of history and Anabaptist studies and director of the Young Center for Anabaptist and Pietist Studies at Elizabethtown College in Pennsylvania. He received his PhD in history from the University of Notre Dame and holds a graduate theology degree from Associated Mennonite Biblical Seminary. His Amish-related research has taken him into dozens of settlements across the United States and Ontario, and has focused on community formation and history, economic and social change, and the role of technology in Amish life. Professor Nolt is the author and or co-author of 14 books on Amish, Mennonite, and Pennsylvania German history and contemporary life. His most recent titles include The Amish, A Concise Introduction, History of the Amish, and with Donald Cradle and Karen Johnson Weiner, he wrote The Amish. And he also wrote Amish Grace with Donald Cradle and David Berserker. Today, Professor Nolt will have a talk, Amish Across America, Growth and Change Among the Traditional People. Before I introduce him, before I invite him to talk, I want to thank our sponsors, the Mellon Foundation and Florida Humanities, whose funding has made these events possible. We would not have been able to do all of the events and the photo exhibition with the family, particularly for the Humanities. And today we're lucky to have the director of Florida Humanities, Nashim Madhuni, is here. So if you want to say a few words.
Around the state of Florida to make it available in venues such as this. This attendance, I would tell you, is overwhelming. I understand in the past couple of weeks, it was more than 20. twice this size, which is remarkable, 1,900 to 2,000 views. That is incredible. That type of metric sets the bar and standard for anything that we've been doing around the state. So you should be proud of yourselves, and we want to continue this work with New College and continue to unearth these remarkable stories. We have some free magazines that look at similar stories around the state in the back while they last. Was not expecting this type of crowd. But the magazines are free in the back. And if you want to find out more about some of the other stories that we're sharing across this remarkable state of Florida, go to floridahumanities.org. And the next issue of our magazine is going to look at cuisine in the state of Florida. So let's see if we can find one of the best Cuban sandwiches. Thank you.
Older ways of life more generally in terms of dress and technology and occupations. but with considerable variation in the particulars and the details what that meant from place to place. Where that leaves us about 1900 is that there were roughly 5,000 Amish people, the holdover Amish people, adults and children, in 44 communities in 8 states and Ontario. That's a century and a quarter or so ago. Last summer, when the Young Center did its annual census, we counted approximately 375,000 Amish in 32 states and 4 provinces, and we could update that now to 34 states because last fall, some folks from southern Colorado moved into northern New Mexico, and another Amish settlement is taking shape in northern Alabama, so we could say 34 states. So this is really remarkable growth, and one of the things that I wanted to start with, because it has implications for Amish life in terms of the variety of contexts and neighbors and economic situations in which Amish people find themselves today. The sources of Amish population growth are no secret, large families, but also fairly high retention rates, the sociologists would say. That is the percentage of children born to Amish parents who join the Amish church. So nationally, probably around 85%. In certain settlements, it's as high as 93% today. So all that yields a doubling time of just over 20 years. That is the Amish population doubling about every 20 years. Some visuals here prepared with the help of David Luthy, the late Steve Scott, Edsel Burge, and Joe Donemeyer, with some maps by Donemeyer and Dale Jones. If you notice, the red dots are Amish communities in 1970. This is 1980. I'll just back up again so you can maybe there's a particular state or a particular county you want to focus on that you recognize. 1980, 1990, 2000, 2010, and 2022. Now that's it's not quite fair with 2022 because the stars are larger than the red dots. So it does exaggerate, but the geographic spread between 2010 and 2022, the 20 teens, were really a remarkable thing. I'll just back up again if you want to know. 1970, 1980, 1990, 2000, 2010, and 2022. So each year at the Young Center, we, again, with the help of a number of Amish folks and conservative Mennonite partners, do a population. Say if you go to our website, they have a screenshot of there. You can download a 12-page PDF with all of the Amish communities in North America. We have a slightly less detailed, but we want to make it more detailed, similar document for older Mennonites in the U.S. and Canada. We publish these numbers in the budget and the diary, and we get some helpful corrections and feedback and additions to the list. Maybe from some people in this room, so we appreciate that. So again, for tonight, implications of this growth in geographic spread. Well, a greater range of social and economic contexts. And so I just thought visually, since we have a screen here, to introduce you to, and in some cases this is an introduction because maybe you're from these places, but well, probably not from the second. But anyway, introduce you to two very different social and economic contexts in which Amish folks live today and maybe have lived for some time. The Napanee settlement since 1842. Now there are 50 church districts there with an Amish population of more than 6,500 people. This is a community that is highly industrial. I'm not talking Amish, I'm just talking generally. 52% of the workforce in the county in which Napanee is located are employed in industry. It's a very, economists would say, sort of lopsided economy, and the Amish are a part of that, building recreational vehicles, heavily involved in the RV industry. male household has Amish, but I didn't put that in here, I guess it goes without saying one or not. Amish male household has under age 65. In 1993, like about 6 in 10 are working in industry in the Mellon community. The percent of working age men in agriculture in 2008 was only 6%. So just see those numbers are. Perhaps if you're from Mellon, this isn't surprising. If you're from a different Amish community or you're not familiar with the Amish, these numbers might be startling. And then these last numbers from 2008, soon after these numbers were compiled, with the Great Recession, major layoffs, Amish people and non-Amish people working in industry and not being lost their jobs, there was a big question of what would happen with the would industry come back? How would it come back? For my purposes, would the Amish occupational profile change in the wake of the Great Recession? And it turned out it did not. That is, it did not change. The industry that was there came back just about as strong as it was before, and by 2015, there was some small shift into small business ownership, but the percentage of Amish men working in the industry was basically back where it had been before, and the number of farmers had not gone down, but as a percentage, that same sort of flat number of farmers was a smaller percentage in the Napanee community. All of this in this context leads to considerable disposable income, and Amish people on a regular basis, you'll see eating in restaurants, shopping at Walmart, whatever. So let's go visually to another Amish settlement. This one, 400 miles north in the Upper Peninsula of Michigan. This is a place that, believe it or not, given its remote locale, I visit with some frequency because this is where all my in-laws live. They're not Amish, but I mean, this is the area that I'm visiting. Amish folks started moving there in 2008. There are about 140 Amish adults and children there now, 15 years later. And shopping at Walmart or eating at McDonald's isn't really an option for these Amish or for anyone else who lives there, as a matter of fact. It's not densely populated, let's put it that way. The economic opportunities are relatively limited, but the economic constraints are also not quite what one finds in Napanee. Property taxes are very low, other things that one could mention. Some of the housing stock now lived in by Amish folks are maybe not, doesn't strike one as traditionally Amish agriculture. That's because there were a lot of abandoned or semi-abandoned homes that Amish people bought, resided, re-roofed. Some other pictures here. Unlike the Napanee Amish schools that have nicely paved basketball courts and ball field, ball diamonds, the Amish school here is mostly known for chopping lots of firewood because most of the school year it's just really, really cold. There have been some efforts to try to connect with some of the summer backpacking tourists that come through the area, and that's been somewhat successful. There's someone who's selling some quilts, and actually using the Amish name, as you can see in the sign, to attract a bit of attention. So use those two different communities as an example of a very different Amish world. It's different being Amish in Napanee than it is in Ingham, Michigan. And one could multiply across the 500 or so Amish settlements in America and nearly replicate that range of diversity. And implied in the previous two examples is the and you saw with anatomy, occupational figures, a range of occupations outside of farming. So the population growth has, as you saw in the maps going from 1970 to the present, population growth, the doubling time of every 20 years, is kind of forcing the spread of the Amish population. Right? It's not possible to for everyone to remain in their home community. There just isn't enough space, even when not everyone is farming. And so population growth is expanding the Amish world geographically, which is sending people to areas where the type of agriculture that they may have, you know, at one point engaged in, and you know, just isn't possible. Dryland agriculture in Wyoming is different than mid-20th century mixed crop dairy farming in Holmes County, Ohio. Right? So people are moving to new places with new environments and taking up new lines of work. So many of the new Amish settlements are started by people who are looking for a more rural environment, but not necessarily looking to farm, or at least not necessarily looking to farm the way their grandparents did. So agriculture, even as it exists, is changing, which I'll say in a moment. Yeah. Some numbers from the Lancaster, Pennsylvania settlement, where I come from. These are numbers that are now about 7 years old, but farming still relatively more common in Lancaster than it is in St. Abney. About 35% of male household heads under 65 were farming, about 45% in small shops, mostly woodworking, metalworking, 10% in construction and related trades, and we round off about 10% in retail stores. I could go on with many slides with particular snapshots like that of occupational profile, where you could go from, you know, sort of like almost no one farming to some people farming, different things folks are doing, Geauga County, Ohio, some factory work, as well as you could see in Napanee and so on. But even in the ag sector itself, where people are farming in Lancaster and elsewhere, there has been this shift from early 20th century mixed crop dairy to often intensive produce farming. And a map here of some produce auctions in Ohio, similar maps you can find on ag extension pages for Pennsylvania and New York and elsewhere. And so produce farming and providing produce for wholesale produce for grocery stores, chain stores, for restaurants and so on, has also been a way to continue in agriculture and continue multi-generational family work in agriculture, but on a smaller, you know, plot of land, say 5 acres. So it does allow for a greater population density in areas where agriculture may still be preferred. Another way of thinking about the variety or the diversity of Amish communities today is to think about their histories and political contexts. So I have three examples here, and again, I'll start with Lancaster. But in the Lancaster, Pennsylvania community, there's a long history, a long pattern of local civic participation on the part of many Amish folks, with volunteer fire companies, with EMT service. In fact, many rural volunteer fire companies would frankly not exist in Lancaster County without Amish participation. There have been some studies across the state of Pennsylvania as volunteer fire companies are, in some cases, unfortunately, aging out of existence, and there's sort of a crisis of providing first responder care in rural areas. And that's not the case in Lancaster and a few other heavily Amish populated communities in Pennsylvania. And entire families are involved with fundraising and funding for these entities. And this has, so this is a history of civic participation that also extends in some ways to a certain amount, not as much as the media stories would suggest, but a certain amount of political participation and voting. Actually, not really enough folks voting to really make a difference in any election, but it certainly is a fact. And I've seen letters from as far back as 1918, when the congressman representing Lancaster County says that he's reaching out to the Amish bishop in Lake Hawk Township, sending him a few sample ballots that I've conveniently marked to indicate how my friends plan to vote. So, and he was hoping, his name was Congressman W.W. Grace, and he was hoping that Bishop Stolzfus could distribute those for him. In a place like, switch back to Napanee, so in a sense, there's also a kind of economic integration there in terms of working in local industry. But there's not the same history of civic participation. It's just a little different. And we see, again, just to use this one measure, voting is not the only measure of civic participation or engagement with one community. But rates of registering to vote and voting are very low in Napanee, much lower than in Lancaster. I mean, Lancaster is like somewhere between 10 and 20% given an Indian election. It's not super high, but it's much lower in Napanee. Then we can go to a much older, dating to the 1840s. So 1840s, an old and by many measures much more conservative traditionalist Amish community in western Pennsylvania, the New Wilmington community, on the border of Lawrence and Mercer counties, roughly north of Pittsburgh, I guess you'd say, close to the Ohio border. This is the community that has probably the highest rate of voter participation, voter turnout of any Amish community in the United States. And that might be surprising if you think of the New Wilmington community as being, you know, relatively more, shall we say, sectarian as compared with some other Amish communities. But again, there's a particular history there, a particular history that involves connections with several key local lawyers and support that those folks provided the Amish community in their struggle against participating in Social Security and gaining Social Security exemption and so on, that's particularly focused in that community and has resulted historically in Amish terms, really remarkably high rates of voter registration and voter turnout. Again, not the only way to measure civic engagement, but one particular way. Amid all this diversity, what might be some common threads, although common threads that also are going to have some of their own variety. One of them is the rise of Amish schools. This comes as a surprise to some people who are learning about Amish history and life for the first time, but Amish schools are a relatively new development. Okay, so there are a couple exceptions here and there that we can identify, but for the most part, distinctly Amish schools don't really start coming into being until the 1950s. There's one in Delaware in the 20s, and there's two in Pennsylvania in the 30s, but it's mostly a post-World War II development. And legally found a legal arrangement that was struck in Pennsylvania in 1955 that more or less set the pattern that was used in other states, first in Ohio and then in Indiana. Famously, Wisconsin refused to follow the lead of these earlier states, and so Wisconsin ended up by 1972 in the U.S. Supreme Court case, Wisconsin versus Yoder. But sometimes that court case has kind of loomed so large that we've forgotten that for the most part, the development of Amish schools was relatively amiable in terms of mid-20th century American policy. Not entirely, but in some ways it really was. So Amish schools are a relatively recent phenomenon. So Amish children were attending rural public schools, generally one or two room schools with their non-Amish neighbors for most of the history of common education in America from the 1830s onward, and many of them continued to do so in the 1950s, 60s, even 70s, depending upon where they lived. And in parts of Holmes County, Ohio, and parts of Elkhart and LaGrange counties, Pennsylvania, there are still Amish children attending public schools, only for eighth grade, but attending public schools. If we go to Elkhart and LaGrange counties, Indiana, we will see that, or we do see in recent decades, that a greater share of Amish folks are attending Amish schools. So this is the percentage of Amish children in Amish schools in the Elkhart LaGrange settlement. So this would be near the Napanee settlement that I've been talking about before. So back in 1979, about half of Amish children were attending Amish schools. In 2018, it was about 72%. Again, we can look at geography, settlement growth, population growth, as at the root of this shift. Going to a public school is generally the choice Amish parents sending their children to a public school is generally the choice of Amish parents who are sending their children to the public school that they themselves attended. As the Upper LaGrange settlement has expanded geographically, as it's moved further east in LaGrange County, as it's moved further south into Noble County, and so on and so forth, more Amish people are not living near the public school that they went to, and they are less apt to send their children to a public school with which they are unfamiliar or with which they don't have a history. So the Amish schools that have been built in this settlement have tended disproportionately to be in the geographically newer parts of the settlement. However, as we see in the excerpt here, the image from the Northern Indiana newsletter, The Lamp, from about a year ago, in very recent years, there has been a really rapid uptick in the construction of Amish schools. So we see there, for example, on line 3, we have 9 new schoolhouses this year instead of just 4 or 5. So the pace of school construction there has increased. So I imagine the next time we look at an Amish school census, I would guess it's, even without having many years passed, that it will be in the 80% range. As I said, we see continuity and change, even in these common threads like education. So an example of change in the midst of continuity would be the School Vest Project in southeastern Pennsylvania that started in Cumberland County, Pennsylvania, in 2014, but is now broadly throughout southeastern Pennsylvania. Kay Moyer, who was a nurse safety educator, actually sort of still is, although she's retired, but she just doesn't stop, and works with Amish schools as a Penn State Extension educator, going into the schools doing safety and health teaching in Amish schools. Kay told me that she and her volunteers had distributed 14,000 vests, and that was a couple years ago. So they may have slowed down a little bit during COVID, but they're definitely still at it. So just one example of new things that are happening in the field of Amish schools. Something else we might mention, and this is a little harder to quantify, but stories anecdotally that I gather or read about, what people, Amish friends, tell me about across the country in the last 20 years has been the rise of what they call supervised youth groups. So these are youth activities that are more family, parents planned, and have sort of a different, just kind of a different tone and character about them. Often coming out with concerns of parents who want something different for their children than maybe they remember from their own youth years. Again, I don't have any numbers for this. I can't quantify it, but I would call it at least a grassroots movement that's sort of percolating in various places across the country. One of the other things that is a really remarkable development that is, I'm not sure it's all that widely known outside of the Amish world, has been the explosion of Amish prints, Amish periodicals, that we try to, at the Young Center, I know there are some other colleges and libraries that also try to collect or subscribe to all Amish periodicals, and it is difficult. There's like a new Amish periodical about every other month, and the periodicals advertise other new periodicals, and so this is a very limited list. So the first ones are, of course, the well-known weekly newspapers, The Budget, The Boat Shop. They're Pathway publications. These are publications that were started by the Amish-owned Pathway Publishing Company in Aylmer, Ontario. Anyway, there's just a range of things. Some of these are targeted at particular demographic groups. Some are trade journals. Even the trade journals like Buggy Builders Bulletin is not just going to have things of interest to buggy builders. They're going to have a recipe column. They're going to have a section where they're talking about who's getting married. It's more than just what's the latest technology in elliptical springs. So and you'll find also that there are, so this is a common theme, but again, there's variety within this. So I did not list Little Red Hen News, but the last one I have listed here is Ladies Journal. So if you, it's a great comparison if students look at Little Red Hen News and Ladies Journal. Little Red Hen News is Amish women's magazine for generally the more conservative end of the Amish spectrum. It's black and white, no photos, not highly edited, I guess would be a way of saying it. But the interesting thing is that when you read it, it's an Amish women's magazine, but when you read it, the articles are about family lives that are so so sort of integrated, they're writing about family activities in which everyone, men and women, children and adults, are all working at things together. There's not actually a lot within it that's very specifically for women, okay? It's one of the sometimes counterintuitive things I think my students find is that one of the most traditional groups, it's not that there aren't clear gender roles, but the integration of family activity is such that things are described in much more holistic terms. Ladies Journal is a much more polished and colorful periodical, and it's much more explicitly aimed at women readers in ways that are that's different from Little Red Hen News. Another example, I just thought I'd pull up because again, this connects back to developments and changes again, also in education. So Life's Special Sundays, this is a monthly magazine that originates in New Holland, Pennsylvania, but has very much a national readership. It grows out of some work that began in 1975 with the S. June Smith Center, which was a child healthy development and child advocacy center in Lancaster, Pennsylvania, that began working in 1975 with Amish schools on providing special ed services and other kinds of things and doing training for Amish teachers to better work with a range of special ed needs in the Amish community. And by 2005, one of many outgrowths of that was this newsletter with articles by teachers and by parents of children with particular medical or developmental needs. Long stories meaning stories that are submitted to this magazine, going into often great, very personal detail about families' experience with the special children that they believe God has given. I'd like to conclude this evening with something that I conclude sometimes with some of my students, which is to talk about the worlds, one way of thinking about the worlds in which we all live, whether we're Amish or not. And so we talk about how the Amish make meaning in the world in which they live, and perhaps a different way than, say, my students or I make meaning in that same world. We are living in 2023 in the same nation, and sometimes are making meaning in different ways within that same context. And we think about this over time, and we think about how our worlds have changed. And I sometimes like to set this up as three worlds that are somewhat chronologically successive, but also there are pieces of all of these that continue, that overlap and that we all live with. The world of the kitchen table, the world of the assembly line, and the world of the smartphone. The world of the table, the kitchen table, these are metaphors, I hope it's clear. The world of the kitchen table, the table is a place, it's a common place for many different kinds of things. It's a place for eating, for talking, for work, for recreation, for worship, a place for all generations. Throughout the day, different people and activities are in the same space, and sometimes those activities are a little hard to categorize. Something that is work might also be recreational, depending who's sitting around the table. Something that might be a meal might also be an aspect of worship, depending who's around the table and how you're construing it. We can think about the kitchen table as a metaphor for, say, Amish schools in which multiple grades are all together in one place, or the way that church is held in the same space where the family had barely eaten breakfast, or might bring in hay tomorrow, or carry out shop work on Monday. Some things may happen at certain times at the table, but time and place are not usually pulled apart or separated. The meal is common food for everyone who's there. The world of the assembly line, pioneered by Henry Ford, most famously, and others, was a world of specialization, a world where we tried to pull things apart, including time and space. One thing, in the assembly line, one thing happens at a time in a particular place, so each space is used only for certain times and only for certain things. The goal, of course, of the assembly line is scale, consolidation, separation, and specialization, with the ultimate goals being efficiency and increased output. And I'm describing this assembly lines as in manufacturing terms, but it became a model and a metaphor, particularly in the 20th century. Work was separated from leisure, residential space was divided from commercial space, and zoning ordinances that started in Irvine, California, elderly to age-defined retirement homes, consolidated schools, lots of students together and then divide them and separate them by age and ability and on. There's a classroom where the only thing that happens is ninth grade English, and in the next room, the only thing that's going to happen is 10th grade algebra, and so on. It's separating things by in time and space. Work work becomes the model for and a metaphor for other aspects of life. Now we have the world of the smartphone, where speed and quantity remain the goal, as they did with the world of the assembly line. But efficiency now comes from not separating, but collapsing time and space. We work from home, we shop at work, we have on-demand entertainment. Time and space are merged together. There are, in many schools across the country, no more snow days. It doesn't matter what's happening. With the weather, you can always have school no matter where you are and almost no matter what time of the day. The internet, the smartphone, wireless technology, all these blur the separate categories of the assembly line world. So with that blurring, does that mean we're back where we started with the table? Not really, because the collapse of time and space is not the same thing as the integration time and space. The individual is now divided in many cases by divided from other individuals by perhaps online anonymity or by particularly curated communities that can vary. So whether we are living Amish lives or non-Amish lives, formerly Amish lives, some other sort of life that find ourselves making meaning in the world of the smartphone with some legacies of the world of the assembly line. I try to maybe mostly remind myself, as I remind my students, to try to find some place to put a kitchen table back in our lives, or to find some way to make meaning around a table, as well as around a screen, as well as around an assembly. I think there's supposed to be some time for questions and answers, and I took the liberty of calling it questions and considerations because I'm not going to promise answers. We will consider questions, and depending what they are, maybe answer them.
If the decision is made to start a new school, how does one go about finding educators, reimbursing educators, and how does teachers' colleges work in that whole ramification of
Thanks. Yeah. So, first of all, one thing to note is that almost all Amish schools are taught by Amish teachers, which means that they themselves are graduates of Amish schools. So they have not attended high school or college themselves. There is a lot of stuff. There's an anecdote from, I think this was from probably the 1960s maybe. There was the first Amish school in northern Indiana that was opening. It opened in the late 40s, and then so maybe this is in the 50s. Anyway, there was an Amish school teacher there named Eli Gingrich. He had moved from Plain City, Ohio, and there was some thought, since this was the first Amish school in Indiana, that maybe he should take one or two college classes. Maybe that would, in the 60s, because it was right around the time they were negotiating the agreement with Indianapolis in 1966, that maybe that was sort of smoother. And he decided he would take there was a teacher ed class in the evening at Goshen College, which was near where he lived, and he arranged for a driver to take him. And on the first night of that class, in September, there was such a fierce thunderstorm that the driver never came to pick him up. He never went to class, and he decided that was sort of divine bone. And so that's the closest I've ever heard, and that story from Eli Gingrich, who's not living anymore, the closest I ever heard to even a consideration of college education. But that's not, your question sort of is more broadly. So Amish teachers, how are they recruited? Actually, in many ways, they are recruited in the same way that that public school teachers in, say, 1900 were typically recruited. That is, particularly gifted or talented students, generally female students, would be shoulder tapped after they had finished school and invited to be school teachers. You will see advertisements, notices. I have one of the things I have listed up here is like there's a bi-weekly specific example I think of is the Geographic Post, and there's classified ads in there. There'll be notices for this school is looking for a teacher, this school is looking for a teacher, and so on. So there are formal ads, and people will move from other places, but there's also a lot of informal shoulder tapping.
I'm curious about the status of the Pennsylvania Dutch language.
Yeah, so Pennsylvania Dutch is the first language of virtually all Amish people in America. There are a number of settlements where there's a different German dialect that's typically called Swiss. Amish Swiss, it's not really like German spoken Switzerland, but anyway, it's known as Swiss or Amish Swiss. So that's not Pennsylvania Dutch, but generally Pennsylvania Dutch is the first language of everyone. Amish schools to connect with the school. Amish schools are conducted in English, so some Amish children, especially if they're the oldest in the family, they may not really be very functional in English until they go to school. Pennsylvania Dutch remains the first language throughout the community. Throughout the communities, there are some families and some pockets in some settlements where English has become just very, very common nowadays. But I would say for the U.S. and Canada as a whole, those cases, meaning cases where English is almost as common or maybe perhaps a bit preferred over Pennsylvania Dutch, are really exceptional. But they do exist here and there. Church is going to be primarily in Pennsylvania Dutch. I mean, the readings from the Bible and the texts in the Alston Hymnal are in standard German, High German. So there certainly are important, essential aspects of being Amish that rely on knowing and speaking Pennsylvania Dutch. So it is alive and well. A friend and colleague in German languages at University of Wisconsin Madison, who specializes in Pennsylvania Dutch, says that Pennsylvania Dutch and Yiddish are the only two growing minority languages in America. Numerically, yes. Yeah.
I'm currently enrolled in a course learning Pennsylvania Dutch online by a person called Douglas Wagenthal. I don't know if you know him.
I know who he is. I don't actually know him very well. He's from Kutztown?
Oh. To my surprise, I'm Dutch from the Netherlands, my native tongue. And I assumed he was either Amish or you know, some kind of Mennonite. Absolutely no Mennonite background connection. It's all Lutheran. Do you know, can you tell me anything more about other Lutheran communities where they speak Pennsylvania Dutch? And how great, how big are they? Do they go back to 200 years, 300 years?
Okay, good question. So are there, say, Lutheran or German Reformed communities that spoke primarily Pennsylvania Dutch? The answer is yes, like 100 years ago. So very, very few, Doug Manafort is kind of unusual in his demographic now, for his age and his social position. But if we were to, say, suddenly transport back to 1830, in Pennsylvania, the vast majority of Pennsylvania Dutch speakers would not have been Amish friendly. So Pennsylvania Dutch is an American-derived dialect that came from the melding of several different German tongues in Pennsylvania, and it was spoken widely by the wide range. There were like 80,000 immigrants from German-speaking Europe who came through the Port of Philadelphia before the American Revolution. They came from different parts of mostly the Rhine Valley, and they essentially created a new language when they were here. So it was spoken widely by all those people, and it would have still been in parts of Pennsylvania, in Berks County, Spoco County especially, Lebanon County, by non-Anabaptists up through the 1940s, and then by some older people into the 50s, 60s, 70s. But it's gradually been lost in pretty much every population except for Amish and older remembering. So today, it's sort of synonymous with Amish and older remembering populations. But again, if we went back 200 years or so, its origins and its speakership were much wider than that.
He still speaks it at home. His children still speak it. So how large of a community do I need to think about when I think of this?
I don't know. If you're in an online class, you should ask him. I know the name. I've seen some of his videos. This is a passion of his. And there's the Pennsylvania German Study Center, again, at Kutztown University in Berks County, that tends to connect with Pennsylvania Dutch speakers who are not of Anabaptist background, but numerically, I'm just not sure who they are.
Hi, thanks so much. My wife and I grew up in Western Pennsylvania, so we're very familiar with Wilmington. We live near Cleveland, so we've got Geauga County and, of course, Walnut Creek. I'm curious, just as the wonder is in the Protestant religions, there are differences in theology from sect to sect. Are there differences in the Amish theology from community to community?
That's a good question, fair question. It's a question I attempted to punt to Amish folks who are in the audience here. I genuinely hesitate to answer because I'm not sure how Amish people would necessarily answer that question. I mean, on the one hand, there is a common confession of faith. It's known as the Dordrecht Confession. It was a confession drawn up by some Dutch Mennonites in 1632. And so that is the standard. Talk about the 18 articles. That is common across all of these churches. You would find certainly different emphases on for example, since 1966, with the formation of the New Order, the so-called New Order Amish, and the Amish Fellowship in Ohio, which now has districts elsewhere, including here in Sarasota, there would be an interest in talking a little bit more about the assurance of salvation, although a lot of New Order folks would be a little uncomfortable comfortable with that language, but would want to maybe sort of move kind of in that direction, as opposed to a more more traditionalist old order view that would say, in order to sort of respect divine providence, any discussion of one's salvation is just off the table, because that becomes human speculation of the mind of God. So and I even what I just said there, trying to sort of parse that out, those positions are much more nuanced than I. So people will talk about a living hope of salvation. Some people will not want to talk about that at all. Not want to use that kind of language. So that might be an example of where, depending who you're talking to, the kind of language they would feel comfortable using would be an example of a difference. There are, in terms of ecclesiology, there are some Amish communities that are known for kind of vesting being a bit more hierarchical and investing more authority in ministers and bishops than others, but I don't know if that's exactly what you're asking about. But, I mean, you'll see some of those kind of differences. There's also a growing network of a fellowship of sort of an older Amish subgroup with some people say sort of tendency is new order, others say no, it's not. Depends who you talk to. The so-called Michigan Amish Fellowship. Because this is obvious, not all Michigan Amish are Michigan Amish, and not all Michigan Amish live in Michigan. It's a little bit like, Southern Baptists. Not all Southern Baptists live in the South, and not all Baptists in the South are Southern Baptists. They're Southern Baptists, right? So there's a certain, it started in Michigan, so there's like a circle of churches called the Michigan Fellowship, and they now have church districts in Maine and Kentucky and Montana and Missouri, and anyway. I don't know that I would necessarily say it's kind of theological differences, but there would be different emphases in that group on, they would tend to talk about things like clean living, which might mean, much more restrictive youth activities or much more restrictive reading matter that would be allowed in the home or things like that. And those might not even be the best examples, but they would probably have better examples than that. But they also have a different way of thinking about settlement growth, so they don't like any particular settlement to be more than one church district. So if they're going to, if the church grows large enough that in most other Amish communities you divide the church district and make two from one, and they would do that, but how they would do that would be they would have like half the people move away physically and like start another district somewhere else. And they do that both because they view it as a kind of not necessarily their language, but we might say sort of a mission strategy of letting their witness be more geographically diverse, and also because they believe that some of the problems with the opposite of clean living, whatever you might call that, result from settlements that are too large, and which the youth groups get too large, and people don't know each other well enough, and so on. So they also tend to actually vet whether you can move into one of their communities, which is quite unusual in the Amish world. So that's an example of a sort of Amish subgroup that is relatively recent. Sarasota is really unusual, and maybe I don't have to say that to this crowd. You all know that it's special. It's great. Yes, it's special in so many ways. As you hear from the front row. Some of the other southern communities. So B County, Texas, the only Amish community right now in Texas is also a little unusual. I don't think, I could be wrong about that, probably am wrong about this, but I don't think anyone there actually owns land. They all rent land, but they've been there for a long time. But people rent land and they tend to work as kind of farm managers for on kind of larger non-Amish owned farms. I don't know what, I don't know enough about the new settlement that's taking shape in Alabama. There's one settlement in Mississippi that is a settlement of the so-called Sturzentruber Amish, which are probably one of the, yeah, like the most traditionalist, to use that language, Amish subgroup. So you're not going to see any of them here in Sarasota, so they kind of live in the south in Mississippi, but they're not snowbirds and they're not going to come here. And in fact, most of the Sturzentruber and some of the other, I mean, maybe there's sort of informal names for these groups, so like the Angadine, Michigan group, or informally known as the Troyer Amish. So like, and there's Troyer groups and the Sturzentruber groups tend to, the Sturzentruber group in Mississippi is a little unusual because those folks tend to like the more northern, okay, so northern Minnesota, northern Michigan, Wisconsin, northern New York, far upstate Vermont, some in New Brunswick, I think is a Sturzentruber community. In part, sorry, I'm running with this, in part because they still rely a lot on ice, for example, do a lot of home butchering in the winter, and they actually, they find the cold temperature to be kind of necessary for their lifestyle. They need to be in a cold place for at least part of the year. So. Another reason why coming to Sarasota in the winter would not work for them. They would get home and they'd have no ice.
Could you talk just a bit more about the Amish school system in terms of the culture that supports and forms the life inside the school and the how the community supports that system? I've been a high school teacher. Some say developed in its present form to support the industrialized society and the assembly line, as you describe it, with classes, individual life, 45 minutes, and a bell rings, and everybody goes to the next place, and so on. How does that work inside the Amish schools? They don't follow the typical American system. They might only have a few years. Some communities might have
So Amish schools all go through eighth grade, so they're all grades 1 to 8. They're slight variation here. Like in the Midwest, it's not uncommon for it to be a two-room school. You might have grades 1 to 4, and then in one room and 5 to 8 in another. Other places, it's a one-room school, grades 1 to 8, all in the same room. Generally, there's always two adults there, a teacher and a teacher's assistant. The teacher's assistant, to an earlier question, is someone sometimes who's a teacher in training, someone who's thinking about being a teacher maybe the next year. Not in every case, sometimes there's only one teacher, but there's often two, a teacher and a teacher's aide. And the curriculum, so I'm not a specialist in the history of education, so I could be wrong about this, but I often describe the Amish curriculum as not necessarily what many contemporary Americans think of as a parochial school curriculum. Like, there's no formal religion class in an Amish school. It's more like an old-fashioned public school curriculum. Like a public school, so like with the Pennsylvania agreement in 1955, basically they were saying, we kind of like the way the public schools were, and we want to keep doing that. So the curriculum is more like a circa 1940 Pennsylvania public school. So that's why it's all in English. Some of the upper grades will have a German reading class, but it focuses on like reading, writing, as in handwriting. So like there's pie charts and graphs and things, but really not much beyond what we would consider to be pre-algebra. Geography, science would be like, it's often called nature study, and there's some interesting, as a sort of side note, but there's some interesting, and some of this, like I mentioned Kate Moyer, I mean, she'll say, you know, there's some interesting things in Amish school science curriculum. They don't call it science curriculum, but like kids often know what watershed they live in, which for a lot of, you know, the rest of us of any age aren't really clear on what that is, which is a problem, you know, in terms of like, you know, all sorts of environmental issues if we don't know what watershed is. So there's, it's more, yeah, it's nature study. It's not, broadly speaking, there's an emphasis, I would say, on problem solving, not critical thinking. And that may be a distinction that we tend to like blend together, but so it's not critical thinking, but it is definitely kind of focused on problem solving, I would say. So that's a little bit of what the school day is like. That's common. Now, what varies then from community to community and from among some different Amish subgroups is that the kinds of textbooks that are used, so in the very conservative, say, Swords and Trooper schools, they may still use like cast-off textbooks that are literally 60 years old. Other Amish schools are using newer Amish-produced textbooks. Some Amish schools are using newer textbooks, in some cases that are produced for Christian homeschoolers, but it's not homeschool, but they're maybe using some of those books in some cases. In some Amish communities, students at the end of the year all take the Iowa Test of Basic Skills. That's not exactly the name, but you know, like it's a standardized test and they track that. Other Amish schools, they never do that. As far as what's the culture that supports this, I mean, it's a culture of, generally of families and communities financially and otherwise supporting the schools and the teachers, and the school is always open for visitors, not necessarily for like me or you, but I mean, it's not, Amish teachers have all told me that it is a rare week that they don't have at least, you know, several visitors who just stop in, usually unannounced. Amish, like usually parents, grandparents, or parents or grandparents or friends of the teacher or of any of the students. So I know Amish grandparents who make it a point of visiting in the fall and in the spring at least once every school that any of their grandchildren are in. And they might have 56 grandchildren in school, so they're visiting a bunch of schools. And so they're just like showing up and they sit in the back for like an hour or two. They observe, they don't necessarily say anything. Sometimes if they're there, the teacher will say, hey, let's sing a song for so-and-so's grandparents because they're here. So they might be acknowledged in that way, but they're there, they're present, they're watching what's happening. So that's the best way to describe the general culture of support, I would say. Excommunicated any more than you could be. right? So shunning is very real and very serious, and certainly does happen, but it's in very particular cases, and so in percentage terms, it doesn't really rise to even the 1% level. Now, if you're an individual or a family in that situation, I'm sure it's no, you know, it's cold comfort to say, well, you're less than 1%. I don't mean that. That's not what I mean. What I mean is that in terms of, so a different way of putting it. So 1955, the Broadway musical, Point of Fancy, which is kind of mercifully faded from popular memory, gave this impression. There's like partway through sort of the climax of scene one before you break for the intermission, like Papa Yoder gets mad at someone and turns around and says, you're shunned. And for a while, that lingered in popular American imagination that every Amish person wakes up every day wondering if like they're gonna like look at someone crosswise and get shunned. So that's not, you know, that's not how it works. But it is, but it certainly is very real in cases where it happens. Now we can get into another level of detail, which is that in the community in which you live or lived in Adams County, Indiana, that there's actually two Amish subgroups there, maybe even more than two at this point, but two major Amish subgroups there. And one of the points of difference there from the 1950s on had to do with some of the details around how shunning would be observed. And so one of the groups said that if you leave the church, the Amish church, and you don't come back, you could come back, and then we'd lift the ban, but if you don't, then this is for life. And there was another group that said, well, if you leave to join another plain Anabaptist group that's near enough, and what near enough meant over time, I suppose, has changed. But like, if you leave to kind of join another cultic, you will be in the band for at least a year. But sometime, maybe after a year, we might lift the band. And that's also the practice in some other Amish communities, particularly in the Midwest. It's not the case in Lancaster County, where I come from. The band is for life. Like the ones or half of the southern of Adams County. So maybe we can talk about that level too of like how things are observed or what shunning means in detail. But it is very rare. I'm sorry, it is very real, but it's also rare.
Thank you.
Okay, so the question is, do people join? So the answer is yes, but not very many. So it is certainly possible in terms of Amish theology and worldview as an adult baptizing conversionist Christian group. Jacob Ammon himself joined from a Reformed Church background as a young adult in 1680, as I said. It's possible. Two of my colleagues at the Young Center, the late Steve Scott and now Edsel Birch, are themselves not converts to the Amish, but converts to other plain groups. And so they often have been contacted through the years by people who are thinking about perhaps joining the plain group, to ask personal questions like, how about your experience and so on and so forth. So the two of them through the years often kind of informally sort of kept tabs on, and they estimated that probably, and some people were contacting them, not just about joining the Amish, maybe joining other planners, but they think that probably in the last 100 years, maybe about 50 people have joined the Old Order Amish and remained members throughout their life, so not very many. It's challenging for a number of reasons that we might imagine in terms of language, in terms of culture, other sorts of things. But it's certainly not impossible. Some people were interested in joining the Amish end up joining perhaps another plain group where English is predominant, for example.
Showed where all the Amish have moved out to one of the stores in my friend's location.
one.